Welcome to Lifestyle Solopreneur, the community for entrepreneurs who put lifestyle first. Join your host, Flavia Barris, as she interviews successful lifestyle solopreneurs and shares ideas to help you find the perfect balance between lifestyle, business, and self. Flavia is an attorney, marketing expert, and founder of several online academies. She's been featured in major media, including BBC World News, The Wall Street Journal, The New York Post, ESPN Television, and more. Join us for this episode of Lifestyle Solopreneur.
Hey, lifestyle solopreneurs. Today, we have the privilege of speaking with Anna Oakes. She's a consultant, a coach, and a caretaker of humanity. She combines her love for humanity with her 20-plus years of corporate experience and over 4 years as an entrepreneur, a leader, a coach, and a strategic business advisor. She and her team are currently focusing their work on intrapreneurs. Can't wait to hear about the difference between an intrapreneur and an extrapreneur or an entrepreneur, and those change makers and innovators, maybe you, who choose to work within organizations. She's also writing a book to help intrapreneurs maximize their impact in their role and their organization while helping organizations lead and leverage this very valuable resource well. She gave her first TEDx in April of 2019 to help people leverage current roles to get the best next. You can catch her on social media, her team site, and the weekly podcast that she has, which is Build High Performing Teams. Anna, it is such a pleasure to speak with you today.
Oh, I'm so stoked to be here, Flavia. Thank you for having me.
So tell us a little bit about what you do for business. Like, how would you describe sort of a week in the life of, you know, what sorts of clients do you help and what do you do for them?
Oh my gosh. Let's see. If there's a consistent week in the life of, you're going to have to let me know, because it seems for the past 4+ years, it's been a whirlwind. But I think some of that to acknowledge is sort of how I'm built. So even in corporate America, I look back and I was that intrapreneur, that person who just was naturally curious, sort of that corporate innovator person. And so that's why that work is so important to me, because I want to honor the people who still work within systems or organizations of any size. And that's really where my work comes in now, to say, like, how can I meet you either as an individual, as a leader, or as an organization? And so I'll quickly go through how I do that. So individually, I coach people one-on-one regarding owning their career, finding their voice, maximizing their impact, and getting to their best next. And the reason I use that phrase, Flavia, is because to me, it's really about, if I'm talking to you, it's your best next. It's not anyone else's. It's your journey. And I think far too many of us get on the sort of career, I guess, conveyor belt and just sort of follow it along. And instead, I really want people to reclaim that career. So I help them individually. And then also leadership. So I do a lot of executive coaching and have for over 15 years been coaching executives, which includes, you know, Fortune 500 executives, all the way to startup founders. And that's something that I've gotten into over the past couple of years, is really meeting those startup founders and helping them on their leadership journey, whether it's solo or they have co-founders. How do I help them, you know, achieve what they want to while also keeping their mental health strong, their partnership strong? A lot of startups go under because of conflict within their co-founders. So there's your individual. I work with teams on high performance. So whether that is workshops, a series of events, maybe consulting with them on a specific project that they have. And then you can take that to the organizational level, working on strategy, both people and business, but really with that humanity side in mind. How do I help the strategy of that organization get to where they really want to go, whether that's accomplishing one goal or an overall cultural shift? So there's a little bit of a broad summary of what I do, but really when I tell people I'm a coach and consultant, it's all about the humanity focus and helping people maximize their impact, whether that's individually or collectively.
That's so interesting. And you know, when you say that you coach sort of C-level executives, right? So we're talking CEOs, CFOs at that level, it kind of sparks to mind something that I tell others, because I've had people say, well, I don't want to get a coach because I don't need that kind of remedial help yet. Like, I'm not that bad off yet. Like, unless things really dive down and I'm just at the kind of bottom of the barrel, then I'll reach out, then I'll get help, then I'll get a coach. And they don't seem to really understand that seeking the help of a coach doesn't mean that you are completely struggling and at the end of your rope. High achieving, successful people at the top of their game seek out coaching. So it's not something just for, you know, when you're really needing, it's sort of your last resort, but coaching is something that everybody should incorporate into their business and into their life, even when they're already at the highest levels. I mean, Olympic athletes have coaches, right? And they're at the top of their game, but they need someone there in their corner to help them get to even higher heights is what, you know, you have to sometimes talk through with entrepreneurs who don't have any help or any support.
I think anyone, right? Whether you work for a system or an organization and you have a boss or your own boss, or you want to get there someday as a solopreneur, an entrepreneur, whatever title you want to put on it, you nailed it, Flavia. Like, the reason they got to be Olympic performers is because they had a coach, coaches actually, right? Multiple coaches in all areas of the business. And as somebody who has coached C-suite people in Fortune 500, I will tell you there are speaking coaches, there are leadership coaches, there are performance coaches, there's a team of people who help those individuals be successful. And if that works for them, why wouldn't we want that to work for us? And so when people ask me for really career or life advice, I say, look, I think everybody should have a coach and a therapist. They're different, but together, those really do help you make a difference in one, increasing your self-awareness, which is the number one predictor of success for anyone. It's been proven for CEOs, so obviously works for anyone. And then as you increase your self-awareness, you are focused on your performance and what is your best next thing that you're working on or trying to achieve.
So one actionable item today for anyone listening and with this speaking to you would be consider whether you have enough support and help. And your family, your friends, your colleagues are not always going to be enough to take you to the level you need to go or to give you that support that you need to be your best and to accomplish the things you want to accomplish. So that's one thing to kind of sit with and consider is, should you be seeking additional help? Could additional help take you further in your life and career? And if your answer and your gut says, yeah, you know, I could use some help, would be putting together an actual strategy and maybe some timelines for how you're going to seek that help out and by when you're going to do it.
And there are so many levels of investment, guys. Thank you, Flavia. You're such a good host to like stop and tell people what the learning is, because there you need to do it at some point. And I wish everybody had the funds or the wherewithal to do it now. But when you're ready, you could do group coaching. You could do individual coaching. I've been in a mastermind for CEOs. There's so many different structures. And finding a coach is like finding a life partner, or at least a roommate, let's say a roommate, because you really want to have a good chemistry and you want them to know things that you don't or have experience in things that you don't to be able to hold you accountable and expose you into new things. So yeah, that was a great point for your listeners.
So let's talk a little bit about just sort of the infrastructure of what is an organization, like a company that somebody may work for as an employee or as a leader within the company, versus solopreneurship, entrepreneurship, being in business on your own, being a freelancer, having that independence. Because for a lot of people, it's not a Venn diagram where two circles converge and there's a lot of crossover. A lot of people visualize those two worlds as completely separate and almost having nothing to do with each other. You're either an employee working for a big company, or you are on your own, starting your own startup, having your own business, maybe freelancing. And there's sort of like people think of it as leaping, like you leap from maybe a 9-to-5 corporate job, and now you are sort of on your own, starting your own business. But let's talk a little bit about the ways that those two worlds actually overlap, where it's more of what they call a Venn diagram, right? There's an area in the middle where there's a lot of commonality, I think, in the transition from one to the other, because there's also a lot of entrepreneurs who decide they want to go back to corporate and they leap back, right? Mm-hmm. And I think both areas of business lend strength to people who have that experience, who want to then go into a different area. And there's a quick story. I once had somebody ask me, I was in corporate America. I worked at a huge law firm, you know, worldwide law firm, thousands of lawyers. And I had an associate who was more junior than me ask me, like, how do you find success? Because at that point I'd built up a good reputation. I had a lot of law partners who would come to me for help on projects, and, you know, my work and contributions were respected. And so this junior associate said, you know, how do I get there? You have a great reputation at the firm. I want to be you. How do I become you in a few years? And I remember telling, because I came from an entrepreneurial background before corporate America, and I told this associate, I'm like, you know, treat all of the partners, your bosses, your supervisors, like clients, like treat them like clients. If you were on your own and this was your business and they were your client, how would you respond to emails? How would you take care of your work product, your timelines on things, your response times? And if you treat them like a VIP five-star client, then you're going to be a superstar. You're going to be a rock star associate. And so if you think about it that way, it might help. So again, for me, there was sort of a Venn diagram, and in the middle was you could treat your employee existence as an entrepreneurial venture. That's your business. That's your reputation. That's your brand within the organization, contributing to the organization almost as your client. So I'd love to hear how you conceptualize and kind of think about the differences between organizations and solopreneurs, which is really the focus of this podcast, would be a lot of people starting their businesses, and also where you think there's some huge differences.
Yeah, well, I think you nailed it, Flavia, that the words you were using about, you know, treating them like clients, I kind of look at it like managing an internal portfolio. That's really where that phrase of intrapreneur comes from. So the fact that we're focused on solopreneurs in this podcast means that the people you're talking to and the people who are listening want to maximize their impact in their career. They want to own their voice and make a big difference. And that advice to treat their bosses or all of their internal contacts like clients is great. Start practicing now. And I think, you know, as we talk about what's the difference and what's the crossover, honestly, I mean, really, I think one of the biggest differences between being an intrapreneur and working within a system, whether that's four people or 40,000 people, is the risk. You're assuming more risk on your own. And I can confidently say that, having been an entrepreneur and now an entrepreneur, managing both multiple lines or multiple businesses, not just one, right? But let's just focus on one. If your listeners have a dream of being that solopreneur and maybe not having a boss anymore, having more flexibility, or whatever it is that's motivating you to have that dream, I always give the advice, look, guys, use where you're at. Start where you're at right now. In fact, my podcast episode, I think last week, was on staying put. My best advice for people is like, stay where you are. You don't need to hop. And you're talking to somebody who moved every 4 to 5 years. So I'm not saying moving isn't bad within your career, but use where you are right now. It's the cheapest and best place to start. It doesn't require a bunch of new energy to go get a new job, and make that your training ground. Because here's what I know to be true. I've worked with people for 25 years now, and the stats will even show you. Look at Gallup or something like that. Only 35% of our people are engaged in their work. It's like, we really got to do something to fix that, because not everybody is giving their very best. So that shows me that we have a lot of room for improvement. All of us could probably be giving, and I don't want to say more, I actually want to say better or differently than you are right now. You could be looking at your career by wiping off your rose-colored glasses and starting to see things maybe with fresh new eyes, dusting off those cobwebs, looking around within the organization, shaking those trees to look for new projects and possibilities so that you're developing the skills you want. Because I think far too often within organizations, we get on that conveyor belt and expect the organization or that leader to push us along, and that's not going to happen. Those people have capacity issues. They're so busy. They also have capability issues. We could get into the stats about how many leaders are actually great leaders, maybe 1 out of 10, 2 out of 10, if you're lucky. So by putting your career, your livelihood in the hands of these people, we're giving up control of our time, talents, and our voice, which is our most precious commodity. And so use your job as a training ground. to whatever your best next is. And the reason I use that phrase, Flavia, is because I don't always know what my best next is. I mean, I look back at my career and I tried to predict where I was going. I wanted more responsibility. I wanted to work at a global organization. I wanted experience being a leader of leaders, right? That led people. So you can set those goals, but then I get surprised. Roles were created for me. I created new roles. I ended up going out on my own and passing up the C-suite role. So you don't always know what it is, but if you are using every day as your training ground to get better and do differently, you are going to be ready for whatever that best next is when it comes.
So true. And you know, one of the things that gets in the way of people accomplishing their goal of becoming their next best and their highest self, I think, is burnout. And that's really one of the core focuses of this podcast, is how do we together brainstorm ways to prevent burnout, recover from burnout, and just find ways to accomplish what we want to do without giving up all the sort of good parts of our life to get there. And I know with the types of people that you work with and coach, especially at that C level where there's just so many demands on a person's time and psyche and emotions, what are your best tips for avoiding burnout, or for people who are already there, for getting out and recovering from it?
Yeah, burnout is so real. And I'm not going to lie and say I never felt burnout, either as an entrepreneur or as an entrepreneur. You can feel that. You know, part of it is we're in the middle of a global pandemic, and so that affects everyone, right? Some of these things are out of our control. But let's look at burnout. And if you're within an organization right now and you're dreaming about your best next as the solopreneur, I would give you three pieces of advice. It would be make agreements, create capacity, and build your capabilities. And so making agreements means that you are going to have to create new boundaries with yourself and with other people. And that means we're going to have to start having conversations about what it is that we want, what it is that we're working towards, how we think we can add more value into the organization. And so one of the best conversations I think we can have is with our current leader. And many of you are going to roll your eyes like, oh, you don't know. I don't have a great leader. They're not very open to this stuff. Guys, looking back at my career, I can probably tell you that I had one really amazing leader. And I'm not bashing the other ones that I had, but that's like that one really got me and helped me get to where I need to go. So I had to obviously have experience in negotiating these agreements with leaders who would maybe not be categorized as exceptional, right? So I've been there. I know where you're at. But again, don't give up ownership of your livelihood and your career because you don't feel like your leader can handle this conversation. You need to own that conversation. And if you're not meeting with your leader frequently, ask to sit down with them. And don't be afraid to say like, hey, I'm thinking about what my best next is. I want to add value. This is the key part, guys. I want to add value better and differently than I am right now. What do you think I could be doing better or differently to do that? Okay. Thank you for those ideas, right? You're hearing them out. Then be ready to share yours. And this doesn't all have to happen in one meeting. This could be over a few weeks or a few months, depending on how fast you want to like push the pedal to the metal, so they say. But you've got to have that conversation. And don't expect that they're going to roll out the red carpet and say, oh, Flavia, I had no idea that you wanted these things. Well, here's all of these golden projects that I've been never told you about before. It's not exactly going to go down like that, but what you're doing is you're reclaiming your voice and saying, I know I could do better. I know I can do differently to add value here. And I want to work with you to do that. And then you start having those conversations with other people in the organization. You're looking for mentors and sponsors and other advocates. You're talking to your teammates. And this isn't about like, hey, I want to leave tomorrow. This is about like, hey, yeah, I have big dreams. But while I'm here, I want to make sure I'm maximizing my impact all the time. So that's really agreements, right? Starts with communication. And can I go to the other two, or do you want to talk more about agreements first, Flavia?
There's one thing I want to say about the agreements, which is for those of us who don't have a boss or a leader or a supervisor, because maybe we're not in an organization or a corporation, that, you know, that corporate environment currently, let's do this. Rewind the podcast, listen again to what Anna says about asking those questions, having that sit down with your leader, with your supervisor, but instead of the supervisor or leader being opposite you at the table, ask some of your best clients the same questions, and your clients will give you that feedback that will take you to that next level or help you strategize what to do next. So Anna, let's go on to the next step.
Yeah. I think you're asking your best clients and your internal board of directors. Like if you have your own board of directors, I would ask anyone who is a trusting advisor for you. So good tip, Flavia. So then you're making these agreements, but here's something, these two things have to happen next because you may suddenly have more on your plate because you're asking for more, you're seeking more or different than you had before. You, as an individual, whether you have a boss or it's you, you have to create more capacity. You have to stop doing things that are no longer serving you. You've got to pause things that can be paused, and you have to figure out then what it is that you want to start doing. But first, you've got to stop and pause to create that capacity, because I promise you, the majority of us on this conversation have a lot on their plate. They're not twiddling their thumbs waiting for something good to happen. You are out there working for it. And the likelihood is that maybe we've gotten ourselves involved in things that don't add a ton of value. Right, I just resigned off of a board 2 months ago because it wasn't fully aligned with my personal mission. And they weren't doing bad work, but it also wasn't as aligned as I wanted it to be. And so I served on that board for a while, and I had to stop doing that in order to create capacity for something new. And I didn't have another board position waiting, but I knew I needed that breathing room to think it through. Does that make sense, Flavia?
Perfect sense. Yeah, it's so easy to just, it's kind of like being at a buffet, right? You just keep loading your plate, and that is not a good strategy either for buffets or for life. You know, if you just keep adding things on without being strategic about where to leave white space and where to create more space, that would be a recipe for disaster. So I'm glad, you know, you're really helping people stop, think, and strategize. You know, what am I doing right now that is maybe too much of a time commitment for what it's helping me do as a person and helping me develop? I mean, anytime you give your time, which is the one resource, doesn't matter how wealthy you are or how limited you feel in economic resources, every single human on this planet has the same number of personal hours, right? Mm-hmm. And learning to leverage your personal time is one of the secrets of success, right? In lots of different ways, either by delegating, outsourcing, but the one you're pointing out, which is really key, is by learning to say no and learning to say when, and also just backing off from certain things or taking things off your plate. And that's hard for people to do, especially when you feel really committed to everything and you've got a pleaser personality where you definitely don't want to leave anybody else in a lurch or inconvenience them. Or in your case, some people in your shoes may have thought, oh, well, now they have to look for another board member and I could do so much here and I feel bad, you know, leaving them behind. But you knew what was best for you. And that takes a really strong person.
Yeah. So, because it is, in order to prevent that burnout that we've talked about, you have to understand that you can't overcommit your time. If you don't have breathing room, you don't have thinking room, you don't have growing room. You will stay stagnant or perhaps even go backwards. So it's about the time, but it's also about picking things that are in alignment with you. And you may have done something that felt in alignment, but after you got into it for a while, it's not working. It's not what you thought it was. And I'm not talking about making like really fast decisions here. Be thoughtful about it because you already did make a commitment. But you need to be picky, right? So I talk about a passion patchwork. I actually want people to have more than one thing on their passion patchwork. I think we put too much stock in finding a career or a job or a livelihood that is going to completely fulfill us. I think that's just as unrealistic as thinking your life partner is there to fulfill you or make you happy. So you actually have to go out and look for that for yourself, but that means you get to put the patchwork together. You don't have to have just one career square. Maybe you have a day job and then you have a side hustle, right? For a long time, I did photography on the side when I was a corporate executive only because I felt like I needed more creative work, like more work that I could see start to finish. And photography did that for me for 8 years. But then it didn't serve me anymore. So I took that square off my quilt and gave myself permission to either leave it free or replace it with something else. Okay. So that has a lot to do with capacity, is really looking at everything you have on your plate, deciding what is most in alignment, what it is that you're most passionate about, and giving yourself permission to replace those things when they no longer serve you. So we talked about agreements. We did capacity. Let's talk about capabilities. So this is, and some of these have crossover. It's not like A, B, C, and there's no crossover, because a lot of the agreements will happen over time. And I tell people, especially if you're working for someone else, it's a yes and. Yes, I will do this, and I will want to take on these additional projects. Yes, I will do the job you hired me to do, but I also want to learn about these types of things. And if you're a solopreneur and you're on your own, it's the same negotiation. It's just with you. I have this negotiation with myself all the time, right? People give me new opportunities. Every yes I give has to be a no to something else. So what am I really spending my time on? And how am I saying yes to what I already committed to for like my actual core day job of my company, my business, however you want to phrase that, and then adding into it. So I'm growing my capabilities, right? So as a solopreneur, you can grow your capabilities by volunteering as a board slot. You can work within the community, right? There's tons of great social justice things happening right now that you will be able to help your community and the causes you believe in while gaining that experience. If you work within an organization, you can shake those trees and look for projects outside of your normal realm of your day job so that you're very targeted, very specifically looking for skill sets that maybe you don't have. Right. So I didn't have a lot of exposure into the technical side of what people within my organization were looking for when I was in corporate. So I actually befriended a lot of the IT people and started asking about their projects. And I gained in knowledge, which then helped me back in my HR world, where we call our technical side of HR the HRIS side. Well, I was a much better partner when I sought out data and analytics on the people that we had within that organization. So not only did I gain in that skill set, and that wasn't something my boss told me to do, but now I was able to provide better analytics to the executives, which was part of my day job, because I actually shook those trees and got the experience. So you see how I'm saying sort of that capability. In order to build that capability, I have to first create the capacity, and then I have to continually create those new agreements first with myself, and then those that I work with every day.
Yeah. Absolutely, 100%. And when you are talking about your sort of passion, you'd make a quilt, sort of conceptualizing all the things that fit together to make up you and your life. Right now, what are your passion hobbies? What do you do for fun? What do you do that drives you that is not work related?
Oh my gosh. Okay. So for me, I do serve on a number of boards, and they are leadership focused. Okay, so they have to align with my passion to restore humanity into the world of work. And so that's a variety, though. I work on a music board that is designed to help artists get more education on what the music industry actually is. And so right there, I combine my love of live music and my love of musician. I was a drummer, a percussionist for over 12 years. So I'm tying something that's personal to me, but I'm also serving. And so my board work is certainly something that I'm passionate about. As a hobby, I still do photography. I do a ton of self-growth. And so I'm always trying to get better. And I would say maybe unleash old habits, unleash old demons, things that I have formed. And right now with COVID, honestly, like my kids are such a big priority for me, Flavia. They're twin 9-year-olds. I have a son and a daughter, Asher and Juniper. And I have suddenly now become a part-time teacher, you know? So it's like
some of
my hobbies had to pause, but I am taking that very seriously of like, how do I make sure I'm serving them, but also doing in a way that meets me, you know, where I'm at and what are my strengths and skill sets, right? So I give them exposure in different ways.
That's awesome. That is great. And a lot of folks don't realize you can serve on a board much easier than you might think. So for a lot of people, especially if they didn't have a lot of exposure, sort of corporate America, you know, you hear like, oh, they're on a board or a board member or, you know, board of this organization. And they might not realize that that's not a path that is closed off to them just because they didn't come through the corporate America pathway. There are opportunities to serve on many different kinds of boards. They're not all corporate boards. You could have, well, this is a subset of corporate, but it could be a nonprofit board. And that's actually very common. That's one of the most common ways you can volunteer to serve on a board. There's also advisory panels. Even volunteering for your school's parent-teacher organization is stepping up, becoming a leader, helping to support an organization that, you know, is larger than you and is accomplishing things that you want to be a part of in some way. So again, a little point today, little point of homework is think to yourself, do you feel you should be contributing more in an area? And should that be through board service? Is that something you should consider? And if it is, start seeking it out. It doesn't always come to you. You'd be surprised how many times it actually just lands on your doorstep. But other times you need to be proactive, especially if you have a very particular niche that you want to contribute in.
Yeah, I mean, every board position that I have had, Flavia, has been because I told people I was seeking out opportunities. I'm looking for a junior board, a community board, a board of directors. I'm serving on this. So when you put that out there, I think energetically, I could let my hippie show and talk about the energetics that happens when you can put that out into the universe and tell people, but then you're having other people work for you and watch out for you. And guys, career is not a solo sport. As much as I want you to own what you do and your time, talents, and your voice, I also want you to enlist the help of other people. And you don't have to, just because somebody puts one in your lap, again, you don't have to say yes to that. Be diligent about making sure that it's in alignment with what you're most passionate about, right? Even the music example that I shared with you, how does it align to what I'm most passionate about? And maybe does it kill, you know, more than one bird with a stone? So.
And let's leverage LinkedIn, right? LinkedIn is where people post their board member positions. If someone's a board member somewhere, there's, you know, a 50-50 chance that they've put it on LinkedIn as part of their bio. And you can sort of hunt down current board members in different organizations that way, reach out, learn a little bit more about what they do. And let me tell you, when there's an open board seat, one of the first things that happens at the board table is board members look at each other and say, okay, well, we're, you know, in between elections or whatever their process is, we need to find someone to fill this seat. Does anyone know a good candidate? And if you've already been in contact with a board member at sort of your target company or organization, it might be one way in. So start leveraging LinkedIn. It's a great research tool as well as a good outreach tool.
And I will say too, Flavia, that I got my first board position after over a year of volunteering for the nonprofit. Right. I'm a domestic violence survivor. And so I was volunteering at the time with an organization that serves domestic abuse survivors. And I planned galas and I cleaned and I painted their hangout room for the women. And I did those things so that when the board position opened up, they knew I was passionate. Right. So depending on how much community service you've had experience, you may need to get in and, as they say, get your hands dirty. At this point in my career, I don't have to do as much of that. Not that I'm not willing to do it, and I do it, but it's with a different time frame and a different objective. So
that's great. And right now, what are you working on that you want to share with listeners here? What are you working on? How can people get in touch with you? And what are you excited about this year?
Yeah. So from a what am I working on perspective, oh my gosh, my team and I are so excited. We've been making sort of this switch over the past year to a new, what maybe I would call line of business in terms of the entrepreneur, right? Before we were really focused on helping the systems, the organizations, and the leaders, but now we're looking at the individuals, maybe at that, I'd say 10 to 20 year, you know, career experience, how do we help them maximize their impact? So we have a career accelerator that we're offering. It's a 4-month program where you work with me one-on-one. My team supports behind the scenes. It's an amazing product. So we've been building that out and offering that just as of the last 30 days, we started offering that. So it's super great. And then as we talked about the book, just constant research and curiosity, that really, when you talked about like what's filling me, that honestly, although it's work, it's really filling me of meeting all of these people who are the corporate innovators or the entrepreneurs, or maybe they were intra and then they went entrepreneur right out on their own and then they chose to go back. Or a lot of people, right? I just talked to a founder that I coached a year and a half ago. They have a water startup here in the Midwest, water-based startup. But then he went back and got a day job. So he's an entrepreneur and an intrapreneur at this point. And how does that work for him? And so just fascinated with that part of it and how I can help organizations lead and leverage that talent better, because I consider it, you know, one of the most untapped resources, you know, for organizations. So how do we serve both the entrepreneur and the organization? I was just going to say, we'd love for people to check out our weekly podcast. It's called Build High Performing Teams. Really, we're talking about career leadership, all of that good stuff, anything to serve you in helping you maximize your impact. We've also got our website. We're on Instagram. We'll connect all of those in the show notes, but just would love to serve in any way that we can.
And I really encourage folks to do that, to connect with you so that when your book comes out, because this book sounds amazing, to be on that wait list and to know about it and to be able to read it and spread the word. Everyone should write a book, I think, no matter who you are, what you do, even if you're not quote unquote literary or writing's not your thing, or, but every single one of us needs to put some of ourselves into this like immortal work, right? Because books live on beyond us time-wise, but also geographically. You never know where your words are going to land. Blogging to a degree is the same thing. Just yeah. Putting ourselves out there, podcasting, it's just such a great way to contribute to the human experience, is for every single human to share what they've learned and what works for them and to help everyone else leapfrog using that knowledge into their own best self, right? So yeah. I really appreciate you taking your time. Again, time is such a valuable resource, and for you to have taken this time to help all of us by sharing what you know and some great strategies that I hope we all implement immediately. I mean, there's some really great ideas here in this talk we've had. So I just want to say to you, thank you so much for sharing your time with us today.
Oh, it's been my pleasure. And I'm just sending all of you peace and progress on the journey, both in life and in work.
Be well, Anna. Take care. And I'm sure we will talk soon.
Hey everyone, thank you so much for joining us, and I hope you enjoyed the show. Don't forget to subscribe to this podcast, and if you leave a review on iTunes, I promise I will read every single review. If you know someone who makes a full-time living from part-time work, and maybe this is you, please visit lifestylesolopreneur.com to nominate a guest or to nominate yourself. Because remember this, money doesn't buy happiness. But money in the hands of a happy person, there is no greater tool.
Today's episode was brought to you by the Get Shift Done program. It's a lifestyle-changing online class to help you define your business and lifestyle ambitions, and to set goals in a way you've never experienced before. This class will 10x your daily productivity with methods that will blow your mind. And if you use a coupon code PODCAST, the class tuition is 99% off. Visit getshiftdone.com to enroll today.